Okay, are you ready to start with the sermon, with the Word of God? Are you?
Yeah.
Well, I hope you're not going to forget to fill in this connection card and also turn it in back after the service. I'll appreciate that. First, I would like to tell you something. I see it, many of the people are missing, and it's probably because I'm preaching on money. As a matter of fact, some people ask me, are you going to preach again about money this Sabbath? I said, yes. And they probably took a mental note and said, oh, I'm not coming. I hope you're not going to do this to me and run in the middle of the service because I'm going to preach about money. As a matter of fact, we started a new sermon series titled The Hard Sayings of Jesus on what?
Money.
And last time we talked about the rich people and how hard it is for them to get through the eye of the needle. And we discovered that these rich people are who?
Us.
Because many people around the world, actually 3.75 billion people live on less than $2 a day. And I would like to emphasize just one principle that we discovered last time. Jesus preached a lot on money because he knew that money matter and they influence our spiritual walk with him. Whether people are rich or poor or they're somewhere in between, our attitudes toward money, our attitudes toward possessions alter our walk with Christ. They may be a wall of separation between us and Jesus, or they may aid us in our walk with him. This is why Jesus preached so much about money, and today we are going to hear a second hard saying of Jesus, a second sermon of Jesus about money. And I've titled the message for today, Divine Medicine for what? What mentality? Anyone knows what monkey mentality is? Okay, I'm going to introduce this to you. Now, there is a story how many, many years ago in India, people discovered how to catch monkeys. And they use them to train them to get up on the palm trees and get the coconuts for them. So do some job. And here is how they caught the monkeys. Someone discovered that monkeys are pretty selfish creatures. And took advantage of this selfishness. The hunter takes a coconut and carves a hole in the coconut big enough for the monkey to put his hand into the coconut. And then he ties a rope around the coconut, a long cord, and he hides somewhere behind a tree, and inside of this coconut he puts some treats, some nuts and dried bananas and dried fruit. And sooner or later, unsuspected monkey will walk by, sniffs the treasure inside, and wriggles its small hand there. And with this, the job of the hunter is done. The only thing he has to do is to yank the other end of the cord and start reeling in the whole coconut monkey kit in his feet. And you may say, well, something is missing here. If monkey is able to put his hands inside, he definitely is able to draw it back, right? Here is where the selfish nature of the monkey comes in play. The problem is that once the monkey grabs the little treasure inside of the coconut and ties its fist around the treasure, he cannot pull out his hand out of the coconut. And you and I, if we were to be the witnesses of this play with the monkey and the hunter, we would have screamed to the stupid monkey, "You stupid monkey, just release this little treasure. It's not worth your life." So this is the monkey mentality. Yet, in our corner of the world, we are as guilty as the little monkey. Because we also have a very tight grip on the little treasures that we find in this world. It's so hard for us to live this open-handed lifestyle. We like to tighten our fists around the treasures. We have almost this primal urge to hoard, to get things, and when we get them, to never release them. We are so focused on the little treasures of this world that we do not even see the hunter of human souls lurking behind the tree. And today I would like us to find a cure for this monkey mentality. In the sermon that we are going to study today, the sermon of Jesus, we are going to discover three cures for monkey mentality. And if you have discovered in this story of the monkey yourself, welcome home. I'm sure many of us are struggling with this monkey mentality. Let's start with the first cure for today. Please grab your Bibles. We're going to use them today. And please open your Bible to the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 6. And I would like to invite someone of the congregation to read for us Matthew chapter 6, verses 19 through 21. And Phil is going to come to you with a microphone so that the people who are watching live or streaming are going to hear your voice.
Do not store up for yourselves treasures on earth, where moth and rust destroy, and where thieves break in and steal. But store up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where moth and rust do not destroy, and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also.
Thank you, Diana. Literally in Greek, Jesus admonishes us, stop treasuring up for yourself treasures on earth. And for some people it sounds like Jesus says, oh, don't have any savings. This is not what Jesus says. Jesus is trying to teach us something else. We human beings have this monkey mentality because we are insecure about the future. We are afraid of what is going to happen tomorrow. And if we are going to starve, if our families are going to suffer, we are afraid of tomorrow. And this is why we approach life with this almost primal hoarding mentality. As we discovered in our last sermon, we oftentimes find Jesus' assurance that he is going to take care of those who trust in him. We find this assurance too flimsy to lean on. We want to lean on something more tangible. And money and possessions and goods seems pretty tangible. Well, Jesus says there is one problem. Possessions are not just source of some security. Possessions can be source of many anxieties. I have acquaintances of mine, he installs equipment. Our audio and video equipment in the homes of very rich people. Very rich people, people who live in mansions. And he says it takes more than a week to install the equipment in all the rooms. So he spends the whole week with the family. And he observes them. And he says, I'm yet to see a happy, rich family. They have so many concerns. They're so afraid of so many things that can happen to their possessions, to their money, to their investments, and so on. Possessions are not just a source of security. They can be a source of a lot of anxiety. And instead of escaping the anxiety, we oftentimes end up with more anxiety. Jesus says it this way. If you try to lean on material goods and they become your security, he says, moth and rust are going to eat them up. Actually, in the original text, it does not say rust. It says moth and eating up are going to eat them up. Some elements of nature are going to damage your material goods. And you probably realize if you look at life, your house deteriorates, your car does not become any newer, you have to invest money to keep it up, it becomes rusty with time. Every single material possession gets damaged with time and becomes of lesser value with time. And some people say, well, what about gold? What about diamonds? What about these things? And Jesus says, don't worry. There are people who are interested in your diamonds and in your gold. And he identifies these sources of loss as thieves. Those are the human factors. And you can call it inflation. You store your money, there is inflation. I don't know, since the Great Depression, this country has not experienced a real crash, total crash of the market, but it's possible. I lived in a country where I was working as an engineer, had a good salary, and the very next day, my monthly salary was able to buy me only 2 loaves of bread. And you lean on your savings, gone. Jesus says, if you have to lean on someone, lean on me. Possessions may look very tangible to you, but they are flimsy security sometimes. Lean first and foremost on me. We are going to talk next sermon about how we can invest wisely in this world, in this time. But Jesus says, let not this be your treasure. And he says why? He says, for where your treasure is, what will happen to your heart? Your heart is going to follow. Our hearts have this amazing ability of following our treasures. And if our treasure is here, in your wallet or in your bank, your heart is there too. And Jesus says, this is why I'm asking you to make me the master and the Lord of your wallet. Jesus does not care about our money so much. He cares about our hearts. And this is why he asks us, give me your wallet, because I know hearts have this natural tendency to follow the treasure. And if Jesus is not your treasure, your heart is going to be somewhere else. I would like to give you this practical illustration with a famous missionary by the name of David Livingstone. How many have heard the name of David Livingstone? Born in Scotland, he was a British, Great Britain citizen. At a young age, he wanted to become a missionary. He wanted to serve other people. And he invested every single penny he had to acquire medical education and theological education, because he wanted to be useful to the people where he goes not just with his theology, but also to help their health. And he was preparing to become a missionary in China, but the Opium War broke out in 1839, so he was not able to go there. And he ended up going to Africa. And over there in Africa, he thought that his primary thing that he's going to do is preaching the gospel and healing the sick. And he discovered there is a social issue that is in some respects bigger than the sickness of these people. Slavery. He will see people coming from the Western countries and go on raids into the villages and towns of the indigenous people. Take them by force, beat them and drag them hundreds and sometimes thousands of miles to sell them into slavery. He didn't have armies to stop that. He didn't have weapons, but he had a pen. And he started writing letters of what he sees and sending these letters to newspapers in Great Britain and all over Europe. And soon his letters started being translated in other languages and also sent here to the new continent, to the United States. And the movement for abolishing slavery began because of David Livingstone. When finally in 1873, on May 4th, he died of malaria in Africa. I think it was in Zambia, if I'm not mistaken. The government of Great Britain asked for the body to be shipped to Great Britain. But the Africans were arguing and they said, this man belongs to Africa. He has spent more than 30 years defending us, bringing the gospel to us, bringing freedom to us, and bringing also healing to us. He belongs here. Yet the government of Great Britain was relentless in pursuing the body of David Livingstone. So finally, the local people carved out his heart and buried his heart under a tree close to his home. And they put a note on the body. His body might belong to Great Britain, but his heart is African. His body may be buried anywhere in the world, but the heart of this man was with the African people. So the heart of David Livingstone was buried in Africa. And I have a question for you. If they have to bury your heart, where are they going to bury your heart? Is your heart in your wallet? Or maybe your heart is in your bank or your house? Or maybe your heart is in your job, where you work 14, 15 hours a day and you don't have a single hour to spend with your family? Or maybe your heart is in front of the TV. If they have to bury you, where are they going to put your heart? Jesus says, for where your treasure is, your heart will follow. And Jesus says, give me your wallet. Make me the Lord of your wallet. Otherwise, I cannot have your heart. See, friends, Jesus does not need our money. He is the Lord of the universe. He possesses everything. He can create things out of nothing. But he needs your heart and my heart. And he knows very well that he cannot have the one without the other. Because he says, where your treasure is, where your possessions are, there your heart will be also. And here we discover the first cure for the monkey mentality. Before I put it on the screen, how many hearts each one of us has? We have two kidneys, we have two ears, how many hearts? Just one. And this is why your heart can belong only at one place at a time. And Jesus says, let it be with the heavenly purposes. Have a single treasure. And it better be Jesus, that He is your treasure. It better be that your treasure is in heaven. Because there is a universal law of love. We give our money and we invest in the things we cherish. If we give money only to ourselves, if we never support the kingdom of God, whom do we gonna end up loving? Ourselves. This is why in the previous sermon we discovered that unless we vote for the kingdom of God also with our wallets, we are actually deceiving ourselves of loving Jesus. Or we are blindsided of how much we love Him. You remember? The rich young ruler, he believed that he loved Jesus. Actually, his actions showed that he loved Jesus till Jesus asked him for his wallet. He ran to Jesus, you remember? And the expression of running to Jesus in the Jewish culture is only for people who are in the lower class. People of richness, of distinction, never run. Then he knelt. He didn't stand in front of Jesus and say, oh, okay, I'm the big deal. I'm Mr. Rich Man. So I have a question for you and you better answer quick. He knelt in front of Jesus. And finally he addresses him by a way that not a Jewish, single Jewish person will address a human teacher. He considered him divine. Yet, at the end, he loved him only as much as he was voting for Jesus with his wallet. So, the first cure, decide what is going to be your treasure. The money or Jesus? And then we move to the second cure, and Jesus gives us this cure in verses 22 and 23. Who would like to read for us verses 22 and 23? Okay, it seems like I scared you. Thank you so much, Charlene.
The eye is the lamp of the body. So if your eye is sound, your whole body will be full of light. But if your eye is not sound, your whole body will be full of darkness. If then the light in you is darkness, how great is the darkness?
Thank you. To translate Jesus' words in a simple 21st century language, Jesus is basically saying excessive concern with accumulation of earthly treasures is an evidence for defective spiritual eyesight and for the darkness of the soul. We'll hear next time in my next sermon that we have to be concerned of how we spend our money. But excessive concern with our possessions is an evidence for defective spiritual eyesight and for the darkness of a soul. I'd like to talk a little bit Greek and Hebrew with you. You know, I guess by now you're already used to. There is not a sermon I cannot skip talking about Greek and Hebrew. So I'm going to talk a little bit about Greek. In some of your translations, you probably have, if your eye is sick or if your eye is not healthy. But when you read the text literally in Greek, it says, when your eye is single. Jesus speaks about a singleness of eye, and you say, what's that? The Greek word haplos means single and has many meanings, but probably the primal meaning, the main meaning of the word is devotion to one purpose. That means your eye has to be focused on one thing. If you start focusing your eyes on two different things, you become cross-eyed or I don't know what else. I don't know if it's possible, but it's very difficult to focus your eye on two different things. And this is where the idea comes. If you actually look at two different things at the same time, you are cross-eyed. You are sick. Your eye is sick. That means an eye that is not devoted to one purpose is sick. And Jesus says, unless your eye is fixed on me, you're sick. You're spiritually sick. Unless I'm your treasure and you cherish something else more than me, you're spiritually sick. There is darkness in your soul. What else does the word kaplos, a single eye, mean? The Greek word kaplos actually is the root word for generosity. So a single eye, the eye that Jesus speaks about, is what kind of eye? Generous. So as a result of a generous eye, your inner world, your soul, will be flooded with light. Because in the Jewish thinking, light is almost synonymous with understanding, with spiritual knowledge. So Jesus says, when you are focused on me and your eye is generous eye, your spiritual life will be flooded with spiritual light and understanding. That means, to present the other side, that means that if your eye is not generous, if you are stingy, there is darkness in your soul. Do you understand why Jesus preached more about money and possessions than about prayer and faith combined? Because he knows that our relationship with possessions can derail our faith faster than anything else. Now let's talk a little bit about the evil eye. What does an evil eye look like? Someone that looks kind of scary and ferocious. No. Evil eye is a Hebrew expression. I told you, I'm going to torture you a little bit with Hebrew and Greek. And the evil eye in Hebrew actually is an expression for a stingy eye. For someone who is a miser, someone who is tight-fisted toward life and other people, someone who cannot give. And in order to prove it, I'm going to give you just two Bible texts. There are many more. And I would like to ask you to read together with me from the screen. Deuteronomy 15, verse 9. Ready? Go. Be aware, lest there be a wicked thought in your heart, saying, the seventh year, the year of release, is at hand. And your eye be evil. Your eye be what?
Evil.
Against your poor brother, and you give him how much?
Nothing.
And he cries out to the Lord against you, and it will become to you what? To have stingy eye, to be stingy person, is what? It's so serious for God. He knows that stingy people cannot relate to him. And he says, do not contemplate stinginess. Let your eye be healed. Focus. Fix your eye on Jesus. And the other text that I would like to share with you is Proverbs 28. Ready to read? Go. A man with an evil eye hastens after riches and does not consider that poverty will come upon him. Who is also a man with an evil eye? He hastens after riches. He is preoccupied only with riches, material possessions. And the author of Proverbs says he does not consider that he is going to end up in poverty. If not literal poverty, spiritual poverty for sure. How many of you have heard of Mr. Rockefeller? Do you know what Mr. Rockefeller, who actually was probably one of the richest people on planet Earth, he had a net worth of $313 billion when he died. He says, the poorest man I know is the one who has money and nothing else. And believe me, he knows what he's talking about. So, Jesus says, do not have an evil eye. Do not be a stingy person. Open your hand. Let go of this monkey mentality. And here's the second cure. He says, have a single vision. Focus on Jesus. Fix your eyes on him. Let him be your treasure. Look at him. Take your eyes from Jesus and your eye becomes evil. And finally, we are at the third cure, and it's found in Matthew chapter 6, verse 24. So who would like to read for us the last text for today? Matthew 6, verse 24. Thank you so much.
No man can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he will hold to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and man.
You cannot serve God and mammon. Mammon is actually an Aramaic word for money. And it's interesting that the word that Jesus uses, kurios, means Lord, but also means a slave master. And when his original audience heard that, they knew what he meant. In the cultures and times when there were slaves and masters, a slave had only one master. He cannot belong to two different masters. And Jesus says, you cannot do this also in the spiritual realm. And he says, you have two options. Either God be your master or money. And you say, oh, but Jesus, I'm not slave to money. I am the master of money. I'm spending them and I'm doing with them whatever I decide. Let me repeat the words of Jesus rephrased. You either serve Jesus and as a result you master money. Or else money master you. Friends, money is a wonderful servant. Money can relieve the pain and suffering of the hungry, can bring hope to the people without it. Money can change the lives of our children and grandchildren in putting them in the right school and education. Money can bring a lot of goods to this world. But money, when they become a master, it's a dreadful master. They're a good servant, but horrible master. And God isn't against you having money. We have to get that. It's not bad having money. As a matter of fact, I mentioned in my last sermon, several of the greatest heroes of faith, like Abraham, was stinking rich. Like David was stinking rich. The problem is not money. The problem is where your heart is. And we understood that if your heart is in the kingdom of God, if you want to love the kingdom of God, you're going to spend money for the kingdom of God. So, God is not against us having money. He is against money possessing us. God is against this money possession. This demonic possession. This demon called money. Money is good in the hand, but don't let him in your heart. John Wesley says, when I get money, and John Wesley, by the way, was a very rich person. Yet by the time he died, he had only 28 cents. Because he gave everything away. He says, I'm afraid that if I keep too long my money in my hand or in my pocket, it will find its way to my heart. Now, if you choose to trust God, in the rest of his sermon, I'm going to summarize it just in one sentence. In the rest of his sermon, Jesus says, do not be afraid that when you are generous, tomorrow is going to surprise you. And you're going to hunger, you're not going to have money to buy your clothes or supply your needs. Jesus says, if you trust in me, you'll not have to worry about the needs of tomorrow. David says, I was young and I'm old and I'm yet to see, he says, a person that loves God and is in dear need of food and clothing and the daily things of life. If you decide to make God the manager of your life and money, he is never going to leave you alone. But if you decide to lean on mammon, on money as your God, and to find security in them, you'll find a lot of pleasure, but very little joy. A lot of parties, but very little peace. A lot of buddies, but hardly any true friends. If you choose to sell heaven for the toys of earth, then you'll have to embrace your anxieties, you'll have to embrace your worries, since they will never go away. In my short life, I've been through several crashes of economy, and I've seen what they do to people. I've seen people, and I've heard from my mother-in-law about her father-in-law who had a lot of money and who ended up, because they changed the currency of the country so badly, the economy crashed, that he was burning millions of saved money in the middle of the room, just looking at these papers that were worth nothing. Do not make money your God. Because where riches have dominion over your heart, God has lost his authority. And of course, his peace, his joy cannot abide there. I would like to summarize this sermon, giving you the third cure. Have a single master. And it better be Jesus. Money is a good servant. Use them as a servant. But do not ever let them become masters of your heart. So here are the three cures that Jesus gave us. First, our treasures are either in earth or in heaven. And our hearts follow. Our spiritual eyes are either fixed on Jesus and full of light, or fixed on this earth and full of darkness. And finally, our master is either God or money. We are either free indeed to do and to manage money, whatever God asks us to do and with money, or we are slaves of worries and anxieties. May I ask you to grab from your bulletin this yellow connection card? I'll be wasting my time this morning preaching if I don't ask you to take some action steps with what you've heard. So turn your yellow connection card to the back, and I've outlined for you three action steps that we can take in following the message of Jesus. The first step, it's a prayer. Jesus, I hope you had time to take the connection card, and there is a pen also somewhere in the pews. Jesus, help me to make you my only treasure, and let the treasures you bestow on me be only stepping stones in advancement of your kingdom. The second step, from this day forward, I want to see my life and my possessions from the vantage point view of heaven. And third step, Lord, I don't want to be possessed by the possessions. Therefore, I surrender myself and everything I have to you. May God bless you. And please don't run on me next to Sabbath. Some very important messages about how to manage money wisely, God's way, so that His kingdom be advanced and also we do the best for our families on earth.